Hi everybody. We start a new chapter today, electromagnetic induction. We will first introduce the magnetic flux, which is given by B dot A, where A is the area vector, always perpendicular to the surface, and magnetic field lines are passing through this surface, and B dot A defines the magnetic flux. Just like the electric flux, we have the magnetic flux. Now, from the surface, the magnetic field lines are passing through the surface. Obviously, when the surface is in aligned with the magnetic field lines, almost no magnetic field lines will pass. But when the area is perpendicular to the magnetic field lines, we have maximum flux. Here, in this case, minimum flux, probably. Even sometimes we have zero flux. Okay, but the thing is that the angle between area vector and also the magnetic field vector is important. Okay, so if the angle between the two vectors is given by theta, then we see that the magnetic flux is written as B times A times cosine theta. Okay, now in order to understand electromagnetic induction, we need to understand the Lenz law. But for that, we have to find out what is time rate of this magnetic flux, d phi b over dt. Okay, so this is changing in b flux. The change in magnetic flux, the time change actually, the time rate. So now, the change in the magnetic flux, according to Lenz law, is given by electromotive force with a minus sign, d phi b over dt. And I will explain you how much voltage is induced in this circular loop, okay, if there is a magnetic flux passing through and changing in time. The magnetic flux may pass through, but now if everything is stationary, no time rate of magnetic flux, so that no potential is produced in this coil. In order to measure the potential in the coil, we can probably get these two connections and measure if we have an electromotive force or something like that. So we have to open this part up and see if there is a current passing through. Of course, we probably need also a resistance here. Okay, in order to find out the current amount passing through this coil. Although there is no power supply, but because the change of the magnetic field creates some kind of potential, which is very good. Some voltage is created due to the time rate of the magnetic field. But now, magnetic flux. Now, what is the magnetic flux? So epsilon is equal to minus d over dt, okay, the time rate of b times a times cosine theta. Okay, so actually it's the derivative of three things which are multiplying each other, so that it is now the derivative of the first times the second and the third times a cosine theta. Okay, let's put a bigger bracket. Okay, plus the derivative of a times b times cosine theta minus derivative of cosine theta is sine theta times d theta over d dt. We have to write it this way, times ab. So this is the derivative of sine theta. Okay, derivative of sine theta actually gives you this term. The derivative of cosine theta is minus sine theta, and also d theta over dt should be multiplying that. So this derivative of the third times the first and the second. This is derivative of the second, the first times the third, and derivative of the first times the first and the second, the third. So this is the possibility of making changes. So you can change magnetic field, you can change the area, you can change the angle. Okay, so this is B changing. This is area changing. And this is angle changing. by changing all of them or just one of them or a couple of them together or something, then the magnetic flux is changed. Okay, so now let's see how we can do this, change the magnetic flux so that we can create some kind of potential difference in these kind of coils. Okay, so now suppose that we have this coil here like this, okay, and now there is a magnetic field due to this permanent magnet, north and south, okay? As you see, the magnetic flux, the magnetic field lines in the permanent magnet is rotating, right? It's just curved like that. Some of them are straight. Okay, so the magnetic field lines are like this. So now what happens is that if we push the magnet towards the coil, let me draw the coil with red pen so that you realize what's going on. Okay, now if I push this magnet towards this coil, the magnetic field lines will be increasing. The number of field lines passing through this increasing because of the curvature in the magnetic field. As you see, in this case, many of these magnetic field lines are caught, but when we have this case, exactly the same coil, but now we are far away from this case, okay? Suppose that you put this permanent magnet far away, then we have exactly the same magnetic field structure, okay? But only a few magnetic field lines will pass through this surface. Here, most of them are passing, but here, just a few of them is passing. Basically, the magnetic field intensity changes. Here, B changes. In this case, if you move this way, B increases, but if you move that way, B reduces. So the direction of this motion specifies if the magnetic field is increasing or decreasing. So this is case number one. We can change magnetic field like that. Or there is another option. Suppose that we have this coil, and then now we have probably we may have a permanent magnet like this, cylindrical thing on both sides, maybe like that. And then we can wrap some cables on the top of this and pass some kind of current. And because of this current, using right hand rule, we will have south here. And if we pass the same direction of the current like this by using a power supply, okay, then this will be north and the magnetic field lines will be this way, probably having some curvatures outside like that, but doesn't matter for us. Okay, now by this way it's easier to change the magnetic field because we can change the current as a function of time. When we change this current, the magnetic field changes also. Okay, when we increase current, the magnetic field gets stronger. When we reduce the current, the magnetic field is also reduced. Okay, so this is how you can make the magnetic field change. Usually this is not the case. Okay, what about the area change? This is number one, case number one. Case number two, when the area is changing, area change. How we can change the area of this loop? We can do this. First, we can have this, and then we can just push this together, and then we can have this kind of area like that, right? Maybe silly looking area, okay? But now as you see, the amount of area is changed now. It was like that, now it's like this. So the amount of area is changing, but the magnetic field is constant. B is constant. Constant. But the area is changing. In this case, this electric field that will create this electromotive force will change, right? So when the area is bigger, we have a bigger magnetic flux, okay? So now the thing is that when we have a stationary case like this, nothing happens, but as soon as you do this, the area reduces. It means that dA over dt is negative, right? So when the area is reduced, some kind of electromotive force is created, not here, because when you have stationary case, nothing happens. You need some kind of change. Only because of this change, there is a potential difference between the two tips. But after this change is over, again, epsilon is zero. Okay? So area change can create some kind of epsilon, which is not permanent, by the way. After everything is over, then epsilon becomes zero again. Good. What about the third case, which is the mostly used case? The third case is when the angle is changing. When the angle is changing. In other words, when theta over dt exists, it means that this is angular frequency. So if there is an angular frequency, or if this thing is rotated, then there is a magnetic flux changing. So let me show you how this can be established. Okay, this is number two, this is number one, number three. Now is the angle, theta is changing with some kind of angular frequency. Sometimes positive, sometimes negative. So the angle is changing with time. So now what happens is that at t equals zero, we have this, but after some time, it is rotating along this, maybe like that. And then after a while, it's probably totally perpendicular like this. So as you see, there is a rotation and the angle is changing. So it was like that, the area vector. Now the area vector is like this, and then area vector is like that. So area vector is, which is always perpendicular to the surface, by the way, is changing, as you see. Area vector is just rotating, and the angle between the magnetic field and this thing is also changing. Suppose the magnetic fields are always like this, constant magnetic fields. As you see, when you change the area like that, the number of flux, the number of magnetic field lines will change. It's like this. Suppose we have this thing and the magnetic field lines are like that. Almost no field lines will pass. But when you rotate this way, okay, mostly they will pass, right? So also you can continue rotating this way, whatever, right? In this case, because of this rotation, the electromotive force that is obtained from this, these two tips, will change. Okay, so what is the direction of this? How do we understand? Okay, suppose that we have this loop here. This loop, right? Now, suppose we have a permanent magnet and then some magnetic field is created. As soon as this wire, which is round, experiences a magnetic field, it creates its own magnetic field to oppose the original magnetic field. So this is induced magnetic field that is created by the coil. But in order to do this, okay, it needs to pass through a current like that, because this is the only way to create some kind of magnetic field. Remember that if a current passes through this kind of round thing, the magnetic field is created like that. We had discussed this in solenoids and also the loops and something like that. Okay, so we know that if there is a current passing through some coil, the magnetic field is created. But this opposing magnetic field, which opposes the original magnetic field, and because of this, a current is created. So this is just the effect. So there is an external effect, but now this thing is giving a feedback to reduce this effect, so that it's passing through this current and creating its own magnetic field to zero, or to eliminate the original magnetic field. So we know that B induced should be equal to B itself. Okay, so this is how some kind of current is created. But if the current is created this way, rotating, so this must be plus and this must be minus. Some kind of potential difference should be passing through. Okay, should be just needed. Potential difference between the two tips is created so that the current is moving along the way like this in clockwise direction. Okay. Now, so basically, this electromotive force is nothing but equal to minus d phi b over dt. Okay. Now, I will just put an n so that we have now, suppose that there are n windings, okay, and then after n, I just take the last part of this to get another terminal, so that the number of windings. By this way, I can increase the potential difference between the two tips by just increasing the number of windings. Suppose that the potential difference with one coil is only 1 volt. If I put 10 windings, it will give me 10 volts exactly. So it's directly this voltage or the potential difference is directly related to the number of windings, as I tell you. Okay. So this is called Faraday's law. Okay. This is called Faraday's law. Faraday's law actually is explaining you how the electricity is created. Okay. Now there are a few options, of course. Okay. In what direction you are moving the magnet? If the magnetic field intensity is increasing or reducing, if the area is changing or the angle is changing, everything really depends. Everything specifies. Everything gives rise to the direction of this current and also the polarity of this electromotive force. Okay, so how can we solve some kind of examples? In the first example, we have the permanent magnets like this. This is south, and the bottom one is north. Probably by passing some kind of current from this wire, so that in order to get north direction, the current should be this way. So the magnetic field is from north to south always. Okay, north to south. So the magnetic field between the poles of this electromagnet, okay, is given by this. Okay. So the magnetic field direction is given by that, and then we put a coil here. We put a coil like this, and then connect it to a galvanometer or just voltmeter, okay? Voltmeter. To measure epsilon, okay? Like that. Okay, so now we have this area. And area vector is exactly in the same vector with the magnetic fields. So they are parallel. So the magnetic flux is constant. Now, by using this current as a function of time, if current is reduced, the magnetic field is reduced. Okay. At a rate 0.02 Tesla per second. So dB over dt is equal to minus 0.02, right? Because this is how the magnetic field is reducing in time. So it starts from B0 and then it reduces like that. So B equals B0 minus 0.02 T, as you see. This is the equation for the magnetic field. We can directly solve by putting this dt to the right-hand side and integrating. You can get this expression. Okay, the magnetic field is reducing. How is it reducing? By using this current. By reducing the current, the magnetic field is reducing in time. So dB over dt is negative. In this case, they say that the magnetic field is reducing at a rate like this, and also the area of the conducting loop is 120 centimeters square. Okay, so if you go from centimeter square to meter square, you need 4 zeros, so it's 0.120 meter square, right? So you go 1, 2, 3, 4. There is one more zero you need, right? 0, 0, 1, 2 meter square. So this is the area that we are using, okay? And the total circuit resistance, including the meter, is 5 ohm, okay? So basically, in order to measure this, you need a resistance. Otherwise, you cannot measure. But as soon as you connect the voltmeter to it, there is also And external resistance that is connected to this resistance between the two tips, so it must be considered. But the total thing is 5 ohms. 5 ohms. So now resistance is given as 5 ohms. Find the induced EMF. So what is induced EMF? And also what is induced current? And also if this is insulator, is there any current or something? Obviously, if this is an insulator, no current is created. So this must be conductor. So for insulators, there is no way that you can create these currents. But now let's look at this case. Epsilon was minus N number of windings is 1 times D over DT, okay, D over DT, B, A times cosine theta, but the angle between A and B is 0 degrees because they are parallel, so that the angle is 0 degrees. So the cosine 0 is 1. So we just have this, right? A times beta minus sine dB over dt. That's it. So the area times the magnetic field, you take the time rate, and then as you see, the only thing we have is just the magnetic field, the change in the magnetic field. So it's just now minus the area, which is given by 0.012 times dB over dt, which is just minus 0.02. So when you multiply them, you see that it's just 0.24 millivolts, very small. So it's millivolts, but even 1/4 of millivolts, very small value. Okay. As you see with this one, we didn't really care what the intensity of the magnetic field was. For us, the change in the magnetic field was important. Doesn't matter if you are dealing with stronger magnetic fields or weaker magnetic fields, but the rate is important for us, okay? In this case, if this is so, if epsilon is given by this small voltage, which is 0.24 millivolts, which is very, very small volts, it's 240 microvolts, by the way. So epsilon is 0.24 millivolt or 240 microvolts. Very, very small voltages, as you see. Okay, now in this case, what about the current? How can we measure the current? Since epsilon equals IR from Ohm's law, V equals, because this is potential, don't forget. So this is equal to 0.24 times 10 to the minus 3, and resistance is just 5 ohms, then the current will be given as just 48 microampere. As you see, very small current, extremely small current, not even easy to measure, okay? Now, by this way, this is a very small current, and also the voltage is very small. Can you increase this voltage? Yes, because you can do more than one windings. So if you put like 100 windings with n equals 100 windings, you get now 224 millivolts. Instead of 0.24 millivolts. As you see, the number of windings really specifies how big the induced electromotive force will be. Okay, but don't forget, if there is an induced electromotive force, like plus and minus, the current is passing through here, okay, also an electric field is created. Don't forget. Electric field is created. Why? Because the charges are moving along the direction of the current. So it's only possible when they are under the force which is created by the electric field. So positive charges will feel, electric field will feel the force like that, because the force is, remember, Q times E. Of course, electrons are moving in opposite directions, okay? Electrons are the ones which move, actually, not the positive charge. Okay, so this is really the case. When the flux changes, you can create an electric field. And also from this electric field, you can create a potential difference, which is called induced EMF. So now, what is the direction of the induced EMF? Induced EMF, in other words, epsilon. Now, Suppose that we have now we have north and south here, and our coil is like that. Let's put this tip here so that we understand plus and minus, which side is plus, which side is minus. So there is magnetic field lines like that. Okay, B field is like that. Now, if you put this, push this magnet towards this loop, okay, then the magnetic field is increasing. So dB over dt is positive. Then this whole system creates some kind of magnetic field, induced magnetic field in opposing direction. In order to do it, it must pass a current like that. So the current will be like this. So this will be plus and minus. Why? Because if suppose that this is a power supply and it produces the current always going away from the positive side. It's like that. It's not the power supply, but it's just the electric potential being created. So if the current is leaving this side, this must be positive terminal. If the current is coming to this side of the terminal should be negative. So now don't forget, the magnetic field is increasing because we are now making this electromagnet nearer. Now, if we have opposite case, now, if we now put this magnet away from this, south-north again, away from this system, then the dB over dt is totally negative because the magnetic field is reducing. Number of field lines is reducing. In this case, we have exactly opposite case. Now, the current will be this way, okay? And then this will be plus and minus. So as you see, now if we push this up and down, okay, up, down process, then we can see that epsilon as a function of time, they can be like sinusoidal, plus and minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, right? It changes in sign. So we can create AC signal. So epsilon will be AC, not DC. DC is, as you see, straight, right? So this is DC, right? Some kind of voltage. This is DC voltage. But this epsilon that we create by pushing this magnet up and down will be AC. Now, can we do the other size? Of course, the symmetric part is also possible. Now, suppose now, instead of having north and south, we have south and north there. So that the magnetic field lines are like this, okay? Originally, if dB over dt is increasing, it means that this is being pushed. This is normal case. In this case, the opposing magnetic field will be downward, which is induced magnetic, but in order to pass a downward magnetic field, you need a current like this. And this must be plus and minus epsilon in this case, because from plus, the current goes out and the current comes into the negative terminal. And now dB over, now can we have the other case? Of course, now suppose that this north and south is getting away from this so that dB over dt is negative. Okay, in this case, the whole thing changes sign and then the current now will try to flow this way. As you see, the amount of this will be plus and this will be minus, exactly opposing case now. So the amount of the direction of the electromotive force and also direction of the current depends on not only the magnetic field, but also if the magnetic field changes plus or negative, right? This is important. So in this case, the magnetic field is always downward. So B is downward, but here in this case B is upward. But the induced magnetic fields, of course, are going to be totally in the different direction. Okay, so now I would like to do this alternator business, but before that I will solve an example. Suppose that we have this now north and south poles, maybe cylindrical, but we just see it from side, and the magnetic field lines are from right, left to right, okay? And we put a coil like this. So this is the cross section of the coil. It's sideways, When you look at the circular coil, it's like this, right? Coil. But when you look at here, you see this part and you see the other part, which seems to be circular. This is just the coil, and the area vector is this. And the magnetic field lines are like that. Okay, the magnetic field lines. So the angle that the area vector makes with parallel, okay, is with magnetic field lines will be 30 degrees. Although they say that in the problem, this whole system is having 60 degrees with the parallel, but the important angle is that the B and A have angle 30 degrees between them, right? So B is this way, and the angle is that way, area is that way, and this angle is 30 degrees. This data is 30 degrees. Okay, so they say that a 500 loop, it means N equals 500. 500 loop circular wire, so it means that they put many wires like that, one after another, right, like that, and then 500 of them, and two tips are taken outside and measured. Okay, N equals 500, and this radius is 4 centimeters, R equals 4, or 0.04 meter, right, because you have to reduce everything into MKS system. In a large electron is placed is placed between the poles of a large electromagnet. The magnetic field is uniform and makes an angle 60 degrees with the plane of the coil, as we have drawn. Okay, it decreases at dB over dt, okay, is 0.2 Tesla per second. So the magnetic field is reducing as 0.2 Tesla per second. Now, what is the magnitude and direction of the induced EMF? First, let's find the direction of the induced EMF, okay? Now, the magnetic field passing through this coil is this way, like that. It's sideways, but still passing through here, original. So it must create a magnetic field in opposite direction so that the current should be this way. In other words, the current should go inside the page here and then coming outside there. So the direction of the current is actually clockwise, if you look from this side. Now, having determined that, we would like to find out what is the amount of electromotive force due to this time rate of the magnetic field, where now epsilon is minus N times dB over dt times area. Because the magnetic flux is BA, but we have to also write cosine 30 there, because of the angle. B dot, don't forget, B dot A gives you B A cosine theta. But this is the only one which is changing in time. That's why I took the time rate of this. Okay, good. So if you put everything, this dB over dt, they say that dB over dt is this reducing in time. So it's minus. So this minus 0.2. So it's now minus 500 times dB over dt, which is minus 0.2. Okay, times area. Area is given by pi times 0.04 squared. This is the area of the circle, times the cosine of 30, which is just square root of 3 over 2, whatever. So if you just look at here, electromotive force will be just 0.435 volts. As you see, although we use 500 windings, the only voltage that we receive is less than a half volt. Okay, so how can we use this opportunity to create electricity in our daily lives? This is important. This is very important. Alternator. How can we describe alternators? Okay, the same system, by the way. What happens is that we have this coil like this, rectangular. It looks like rectangular. Okay, so just one windings. Now we make one of the tip is short or longer, and then we put some kind of ring like this, so that when this whole thing rotates, because we will need some kind of rotation. So the whole system, the area will rotate. So the angle will change in time with a angular frequency. which is theta times t, right? So angular frequency is the angle times time. Or sorry, I made a mistake. W is equal to d theta over dt. Okay, theta equals omega t. Okay, so this is something that we always keep remembering. We put another ring here. So now this side of the ring of the loop touches the inner surface. And then we get a contact from here. And then we measure epsilon. I don't know in what direction it will rotate. It's rotating like that. But what about the direction of the magnetic field? Assume that magnetic field direction is this way. Probably from a permanent magnet. B is this way. The area is perpendicular always, okay, 90 degrees. So this whole thing, when rotating, makes some angles with this magnetic field. For instance, when in this case, we have a minimum flux, but when we have this kind of thing, when the magnetic field is this way, we have maximum amount of flux here. So this whole thing is rotating, don't forget, around this thing, center. Okay? So maybe you can put a like cylinder, plastic cylinder, and then connect a motor to this and rotate the whole system. You can do that. In this case, what happens is that because of the change in the magnetic flux, we will have epsilon, but epsilon will be alternating. Okay, like this. So with the constant rotation, of course, the frequency is determined by this. If this rotation is slow, it means that omega is small. We will have this kind of potential change in time. But if the fast rotation is done, so W is high, then we have this kind of behavior. Okay? As you see now, the frequency changes depending on how fast the whole thing is rotating. Now, not only the epsilon is changing, but also the magnetic flux is changing. So magnetic flux is totally opposing to this one. So this is d phi b over dt, because epsilon is equal to minus of d phi b over dt. Okay, so we can create electricity by this way. Usually, this rotation is the key thing. So rotation. If you can rotate the coils like this, okay, but not one, but many coils maybe, okay, like with some angles. So here also, like that. So you can just put these windings like this, and many windings you can just put on a surface so that the number of windings can be increased, and also the voltage amount is also created by putting more and more windings. But the rotation is the key issue. If you can rotate the whole system, then by using permanent magnets, okay, north and south, these are usually permanent magnets, because you don't want to spend energy to electromagnet to create electricity. You don't want to use electricity to create electricity, right? It's better to use permanent magnets. So the magnetic field is automatically created by just putting two magnets together. All you have to do is just pay money for the magnets, and just here you have the magnetic field, okay? Not for free, but cheaper, of course. Cheaper than electromagnet case. In this case, we create electricity, right? Now, how can we create the rotation? In power plants, we have heat source. Heat, some kind of Q, heat is given to water, okay? So water, by using some kind of pump, okay? The water just goes through the pump, and due to the heat exchanger here, it is heated up, and then a steam is produced. Here, in the inlet, this is water, but now when it goes out, steam with high pressure. Okay, It's of course the temperature is more than 100 because 100 is the boiling temperature of water, and the temperature of the steam, which is like gas. As you see, the water, which is in liquid state, change the state and to go to into gas phase. And due to this Q given by some system, this system can be given by coal, thermic electric power plants, also nuclear fuel, nuclear power plants, or maybe natural gas. So these are the basic three ways to create some kind of heat, but the rest is the same. So this high pressure steam goes into turbines. Turbines have some blades, you know, rotating thing. Because of the pressure, it's like the ventilator. So when you create these blades such that with some kind of curvature, high pressure steam just hits it and rotates it, and this rotation is created. And this is the rotation that we are talking about. This rotation, right? Now we can create rotation. As you see, obtaining this kind of rotation is not easy. You have to do lots of stuff. Anyway, once you can get this rotation, you can just connect this to an alternator. Okay, these alternators that we are talking about is like the radius of this is a few meters. Think about that. It's a big, huge, and thousands of number of windings are used in order to get a high voltage electricity. So the electricity is produced. Of course, the steam now is condensated, maybe some kind of heat transfer, and then converted into water again and given to the system. So this is circulating water, but now the same amount, similar amount of heat, probably less than Q1, because some of them is used to do work of this rotating turbines. So it's given outside, but this rotation creates electricity. So this creates electricity with three phases, okay? So basically, it comes to our homes by using these poles, and three wires are seen, as you see. In each one of them, three wires. These are, but the thing is that after this is produced, you need a step-up transformer. These transformers make these voltages like a few hundred, 300 to 400 volts to 10 to 40,000 volts. It's incredible, isn't it? It's an AC voltage like this, but 40,000 volts. That's why it's very dangerous, high voltage. If you use high voltage, transferring these voltages, loses less amount of power, because this power spent on the wires are given by P equals I square R. They have the resistance, of course. These are the thick wires which have some resistance. But when the current is high, then the power loss will be higher. In order to eliminate this, you need to make this power, this current as small as possible. Power is also V times I. So how can I make this I as small as possible? Suppose that this is like megawatts, right? The power is megawatts. In this case, if this is 1 ampere, then this would be 1,000,000 volts, right? It's not possible. But if you do this 40,000 volts or 50,000, 100,000 volts sometimes, you can make this as small as possible. Otherwise, you have a big amount of current you have to pass from these things, and obviously they will just get lost. So the energy will get lost. So you need a step-up transformer from 300, 400 volts to about 40,000 volts. And then after that, you need a step-down transformer. Probably one of them is your neighborhood. It's like a house in which a big transformer continuously works, running and creating small voltages. Also, there is one thing. So this electricity is, this part is connected to earth. And then this earth also has 0 volts, right? Earth is assumed to be 0 volts. So you don't need to you don't need another connection for earth. But in our homes, we use only one phase and this earth, okay? So we use only two of them, single phase. But in industry and in some intelligently designed motors, they use three phases. But at home, we use only one phase. And one of the tip of these plugs that on the wall that we get electricity from is connected to Earth, which is 0 volts. Okay, so this is how the electricity is created. Doesn't matter what kind of source you are using, but this is the power plant that electricity is produced from. And the biggest and important part is the alternator. Okay, this. Without this, you can never produce electricity. So the hair dryer that you are using needs electricity, and it is obtained from some kind of alternator, which is huge, thousands of kilograms or something, including lots of copper coils, very thick, maybe as thick as like our finger size or something. So anyway, this is really important. So magnetic fields, when they are used, you can get really some interesting things. And of course, the electricity in our case from it, if carefully designed systems are produced. Okay, so this is the end of our today's lecture. And I will stop recording.